dikes protect the land interior from flood events. The special design ensures that no water spills over the dike. Nevertheless, in the event of loading, quantities of water can penetrate the structure and even hollow it out in damaged areas. Regular checks of the water content and the body of the dike are therefore necessary to ensure its stability. Such analyses can be carried out using geophysical techniques. Geoelectric measurements are particularly suitable for this. Using them, differences in the electrical conductivity and thereby also in the water saturation inside the dike can be measured without damaging it. Water increases the conductivity because it contains free ions which increase the flow of electric current. Hello and welcome. What physical quantities are measured in geoelectrics and what subsurface properties can be derived from them? What experimental setup is required for this? In this video, I shall explain the concept of geoelectrics as well as the physical fundamentals upon which it is based. You will learn how electrical voltages are artificially applied in the earth and how you can deduce the properties of the subsurface from measurements on the surface. I will then show you the procedure using the example of an infiltration experiment. Geoelectric measurements allow the path of the water to be tracked. The basic approach of geoelectrics is to supply a current into the earth so that the electrical conductivity of the subsurface can be studied. A material is conductive if it contains free charge carriers that allow charge to be transported. Under these conditions, then a current can flow. In metallic conductors, the charge carriers are electrons. In rocks, however, charge transport occurs mainly through free ions, sometimes dissolved in water. I shall explain the physical parameters of this process using the example of a cylindrical test body. This might be, for example, a wire through which current flows. Here, I use the reciprocal of the conductance, namely the electrical resistance R. This depends on the length L of the body, its cross-sectional area A, and the resistivity rho. R equals rho times L divided by A. With an applied voltage of U and a current of I, for rho this results in U divided by I times A divided by L. The resistivity rho, or specific resistance, is a material property and does not depend on the length of the conductor. Unlike in electronics, the current flow in the earth is not just restricted to a metallic wire. As such, one cannot measure the resistivity of the subsurface directly. Rather, in practice, a voltage is applied between two stainless steel spikes acting as electrodes. In this way, the current can flow through the subsurface from one electrode to the other. In this process, an electric potential field arises as well as a potential difference between the two electrodes. However, this potential difference also contains the voltage drop at the spikes, since there is a contact resistance between the contact surfaces of the spikes and the subsurface. In order for this effect not to affect the measurement, the potential difference must always be measured with separate spikes, also called probes. As such, a four-pole measuring geometry is typically used for the experimental setup. Between the two electrodes for supplying the current, two more probes are inserted. By using them, the electrical potential difference at the surface can be measured. And by doing this, the voltage drop at the current supplying electrodes is not measured. The ratio of the measured potential difference U to the supplied current I multiplied by a geometry factor F gives the apparent resistivity rho A of the materials through which the current flows. This apparent resistivity is ultimately the parameter which geoelectric measures. It depends on the measuring geometry and the distribution of the resistivity in the subsurface. In order to investigate the distribution of the resistivity, the measurement geometry, or better said, the experimental setup, must be adapted to the target area in the subsurface. Two typical measuring geometries are the so-called Wenner and Schlumberger geometries. A Wenner geometry is used to map the subsurface at a fixed depth. For this purpose, the distance between all four probes is chosen to be the same. This arrangement is particularly sensitive to depth of 0.3 to 0.5 times the spacing of the probes. In order to measure a profile, many metal spikes are in practice inserted one behind the other at a selected distance, and four adjacent spikes are connected to the measuring apparatus. The apparent resistivity rho A is then calculated from 2 pi times u divided by I times A. Then the connections along the profiles are replaced and the measurement is repeated. This results in measurements at the same spacing along the profile. To calculate a depth profile for the resistivity, the Schlumberger geometry is used. This also uses four electrodes. Unlike the Wenner geometry, the two outer electrodes that supply the current remain fixed at a distance of L. The two measuring probes are variable and arranged symmetrically to the profile center at a distance A. Rho A results from pi over 4 times u divided by I times L squared minus A squared divided by A. After each measurement, only the distance between the two measuring electrodes is changed. The further apart they are, the deeper the subsurface area to which the measuring setup is sensitive. As a rule of thumb, the range from the subsurface up to a depth of about twice the probe distance has an influence on the measurement. In addition, many other measurement geometries are available, each of which has a different focus. For a tomography, one combines, for example, many different Wenner and Schlumberger geometries that are measured automatically. A tomography in geoelectrics thereby inverts the measurement eta of various Wenner and Schlumberger geometries. For the tomography and for the Wenner geometry, I shall show you here the example of an infiltration experiment. As in the case of a dike, it is also possible to study the propagation of water in the subsurface. For this purpose, we deliberately infiltrated water into the ground using a bottomless tank to measure how it spreads using geoelectrics. Here is a plot of the apparent resistivity of two Wenner measurements. Once before the water infiltration in orange and once afterwards in blue. The comparison allows us to track the effects of the water dispersion. The measuring profile leads directly past the water tank. It is located at profile meter number 5. Here, the probe distance is 50 cm. This means that the sensitive depth range is between 15 and 25 cm. You can clearly see how the curve drops within the range of profile meters 2 to 7. Before and behind it, the level of the first measurements is retained. Obviously, water has penetrated into the subsurface and thereby reduced its resistivity. As a second part of the evaluation, here I shall show you a tomographic model for the resistivity of the depth section below the profile. It represents the model that best explains the measurement data at the surface before the water infiltration. For comparison, the results of a measurement some 60 minutes after the infiltration are shown here. You can see here how the blue area with reduced resistivity spreads out under the tank in a depth of about 2 meters. Clearly, the water has encountered a barrier here that prevents any further penetration. Similar analyses are also possible on dikes or dams, where they allow their stability to be assessed. In this video, I have explained the method of geoelectrics using the example of a water infiltration experiment. Water reduces the resistivity in the subsurface, and with the help of geoelectrics, such areas can be illuminated. For this purpose, current is supplied via two electrodes and the voltage drop is measured using two additional probes. From this, the measured variable of the apparent resistivity can then be determined. Various measurement geometries are available for mapping along profiles, probing in depth, or tomography. For all variants, the subsurface property of resistivity can be derived.